Welcome to counseling class. Today we shall take up Block 5, Midnight Children by Salman Rushdie. Salman Rushdie's Midnight Children, a mind-blowing writer and a mind-blowing kind of novel that has created a storm of controversy ever since its publication, but accepted worldwide as a new classic, a trendsetter in the history of Indian English fiction. And hence, we have to handle it very carefully, more because of the fact that it is highly experimental in theme and form, in narrative technique. It's a highly experimental work in which Rushdie has made daring innovations. So that is what we shall be trying to mark as we go through this block. It has been excellently written by Professor Anjali Roy and Professor Binay Kirpal, both IITs professors, one from Mumbai, another from Kharagpur. So unit one, background, Salman Rushdie's brief life history. And the reception of the novel in 1981, immediately after its publication, how the book was received. There are continual references to postmodernism, postcolonialism, and reader response theory. I would request you to go through an important book, Reader's Guide to Contemporary Critical Theory. Reader's Guide to Contemporary Critical Theory, a very lucidly written book on theory. There are 1001 books on theory, but this Reader's Guide is an excellent book, very handy, easily accessible. You can go through that. It might be available in your library. Reader's Guide to Contemporary Literary Theory. And try to collect some information on postmodernism, postcolonialism, reader response theory. Reader response theory is a very important fundamental theory which believes that the response to a work of art varies from generation to generation and reader to reader. In other words, as has been introduced in this book, the popularity, the success of a work depends on its multivalence. That is, despite a changing readership, they have a special value for everyone. Reader response theory. Then postmodernism, whether a challenge or an extension of modernism, and postcolonialism, the literature of protest in the erstwhile, produced in the erstwhile colonies. These three or four theories are important because they are continually being referred to in this block. How is Salman Rushdie postmodern? Is he really postcolonial? And how do the readers respond to his absolutely mind-blowing experimentation in the form and content of the novel? These things have to be taken into consideration for a better understanding of this seminal work, which is considered important next only to Gabriel Garcia Marquez, known for his 100 years of solitude. Then the Book of Laughter and Forgetting by Milan Kundera, and one or two other books. 100 years of solitude makes you imagine. That was again an earthquake. An earthquake in the history of global fiction, produced by a Latin American writer, Marquez. It is suggested that this gentleman, Salman Rushdie, might have been influenced by these two or three writers, Marquez and Milan Kundera and others. But he says, well, I came to Marquez only after I sent my book, Midnight Children, for publication. Well, it was a kind of a coincidence, maybe, or readers and critics have been overreacting. But then the fact remains that magic realism is a new mode of narrative that was popularized by Gabriel Garcia Marquez. And Salman Rushdie looks like belonging to the same genre of fiction writing. But Salman Rushdie extends the borders of fiction in this novel, Midnight Children. You know the personal history of Salman Rushdie. This novel is centrally focused on one thing, and that is very lucidly written on page 7. He makes a very important statement. We are radioactive with history. Third paragraph. We are radioactive with history, and politics is history's present tense. While he was reacting to the reader's questions in an interview, politics is history's present tense. So how can a writer remain away from contemporary politics? How can a writer remain away from contemporary history? Or the history of a nation, history of a country. Though time and again he has said that my novel, Midnight Children, is not a definitive historical account. I have taken liberty with the form. And in fact, as we shall see, he has mixed up several forms of storytelling, fiction writing and storytelling, to achieve spectacular success through this novel, and became a global phenomenon. So Rushdie, the man, is as much important for us as the writer. His life in Mumbai, childhood, then to Karachi, then to England. The novels he has written, the great controversy he has stirred with the publication of the Satanic Verses, then remaining in hiding for 12 years, till Ayatollah Khomeini lifted the fatwa. You know these things, historical facts. There in the life and times of Salman Rushdie. One thing I would like to tell you, Midnight Children is not his first novel. The first novel is Grimers. Grimes was also an experimental work, but it was a flop. It was a flop. It was not received well. People are very critical of the form of the novel. So it was a cause of great disappointment for the young writer, Salman Rushdie. And then he took some time to concentrate on the Indian subcontinent, particularly India and Pakistan, on the type of protagonist he would be inventing, and Salim is his protagonist. There is mystery, there is doubt, there is suspicion hovering around all these characters and events. For example, Salim's birth. Salim was swapped during his birth. He really doesn't belong to his parents. Someone else belongs to his parents. But there is a kind of swap accident in the hospital, in the nursing home. Then Salim, the protagonist, takes upon himself the task of storytelling by mixing up several strands of storytelling. In fact, a very important thing you must remember, the novel is more concerned with storytelling than the story. The daring experiments spring from the fact that the protagonist Salim is more concerned with storytelling, the technique of storytelling, the methodology of storytelling, than the story itself. So no wonder Salim is a different kind of a narrator who commits mistakes, even to the extent of suggesting that Ramayana was dictated to Ganesha to take down, which is absolutely a fatal error. And on that, Rushdie had to face criticism. It was Vyasa who dictated Mahabharata to Ganesha, not Ramayana. Not Valmiki dictated. Valmiki dictating Ramayana to Ganesha is absolutely wrong. Rushdie was caught on the wrong foot by the critics and interviewers. How come you have written on the tradition and culture of a nation about which you are unaware? How come you have given complete a set of misinformation to the reading public? You should have gone into the cultural background of India. Then Rushdie had a very simple answer. You know, my narrator, Salim, the protagonist, that is, my narrator protagonist is never a reliable protagonist. My narrator is never a reliable narrator. I have not committed the mistake. My narrator has committed the mistake. Very cleverly he escaped. There are similar mistakes with regard to events and dates. Events and dates. Again, the onus falls on the narrator and not on the author. So whenever we are discussing the novel, we must present it from the point of view of the narrator, protagonist, and not use Rushdie / Salim or Salim / Rushdie. That's the wrong way. Rushdie is the writer, but Salim is the protagonist. We cannot use both the names at the same time with a slash in between. Okay? We must say that Rushdie has written this novel and Salim is his protagonist. Salim is the narrator, central protagonist, the narrator of the story, who has taken liberty, with the form of storytelling. And there is uncanny mystery, bizarre, fantasies, fairy tale, atmosphere. What is Salman Rushdie up to? You will be asking while reading the novel. It makes very difficult reading because it attempts a complex theme, a complex protagonist, absolutely new, absolutely innovative, which was never done in the history of Indian English fiction. And so much so that this book became a trendsetter, and there have been many young writers who are under the direct impact of Salman Rushdie's Midnight Children, writing novels on the history of India, particularly pre and post independence India. Salman Rushdie concentrates on Bombay happens to be the background to many of his novels. There is a brief historical survey, page 12 and 13, page 13, historical survey. Page 13, Rushdie has written 10 works between Grimus and the Ground Beneath Her Feet. Grimus and Ground Beneath Her Feet, you can look at page 13, first paragraph. What are those 10 works? Five novels, one work of science fiction, one work of children's fiction, one a collection of short stories, a travelogue, and one collection of essays. Well, very interesting thing about Salman Rushdie is that some of the ideas are repeated in the stories, in the essays, even in the interviews. We shall be coming in detail to Midnight Children, but before that, same published in 1983, came next to Midnight Children. It is his second major book about the Indian subcontinent. Last but one paragraph, page 13. Grimus, before that, Grimus was published in 1977. It was a failure. Then in same, the narrator is an expatriate who returns to Pakistan for an extended visit as an outsider who is also a cultural insider. The perspective he gives is a portrait of corruption and shamelessness among the ruling elites of Pakistan. Same was followed by the most controversial book of Salman Rushdie, The Satanic Verses. You must know something about Satanic Verses because this put him into a trouble, and great trouble, in fact. He became underground for more than 12 years. That was meant to give voice and fictional flesh to the immigrant culture. It was an attempt to explore the nature of divine revelation, that is the Quran, from the point of view of secular person. What is divine revelation? What does Quran say? His critical comments on Quran landed him in great trouble. As I said, Ayatollah Khomeini of Iran imposed fatwa on him and his life was at great risk. The entire Muslim world was taken by storm. Worldwide criticism. But at that time, the writers, the activists, the intellectuals, the elites, the critics came forward to help Surajdi by providing active support. That was a very positive development. But then when Rajdi's life was at risk, he had no other option but to keep himself in hiding. He went on changing his place from time to time. He put on disguise, and people, particularly the Muslim clerics and their agents, were not able to trace him. So that was the very unfortunate part of the story. Then you have Harun and the Sea of Stories, 1990. Harun is a rejoinder, it's a reply. It's 14 second paragraph. Why? The paucity of light. Look at page 14, second paragraph. Rushdie apologized to the Muslim world following the worldwide reaction against the satanic verses. But here, in this novel, in his heart of hearts, one can see him feeling that he had every right to write what he did. He might have apologized to the Muslim world, but his conviction was that as a writer, as a creative writer, he had the freedom to write what he wrote in the satanic verses. It's a delightful children's story on one level, but on the other, it is the story of his forced imprisonment in an unknown place and the silence imposed on him by the sentence passed on him by Ayatollah Khomeini. In this book, Harun and the Sea of Stories, Khomeini, the great Muslim cleric who imposed the fatwa, is King Khatam Sud, who is the arch enemy of all stories and the flow of speech. A typical kind of king who never allows freedom of speech and is an enemy of all stories, all fiction. Then you have East West, 1994. It's a collection of short stories where the theme of East West comes again and again. Then you have The Moor's Last Sigh. Moore's Last Sigh, another important novel published in 1995, is a story of Morris Zogoyevai, who was exiled twice, once when his mother turns him out of his house in Bombay, and next when the forces of oppression seek him and he escapes to Spain. It is a story of a character on the run. The escape, the flight, the unending journey is an image that repeatedly occurs in all expatriate fiction. Expatriate fiction is conditioned by, characterized by these things: unending journey, escape, flight, sudden encounters, etc. One of the very, at a very crucial moment of the novel, Morris fears he will lose his sanity in the imprisonment imposed on him by his tormentor. Again, there are examples of uttering verses. Powerful work is a big love and us. Almost come out, Vina Apsara meet when she comes from New York as a refugee, fall in love and marry. But one day, Vina vanishes from Bombay. Vina disappears, and Ormus, like Orpheus, the mythical Orpheus of Greek story, is doomed to Sasha. He went on searching her after she disappeared. So this is for nostalgic which is typical of a success writing. You come to Midnight Children. Midnight Children draws his inspiration from the hour of India's independence, 15th August 1947. All the children born together at that momentous hour become in Rushdie's novel the children of the time. Remember, 14th midnight 1940, First Minister Jawaharlal Nehru declaring on the floor of the parliament, at the stroke of the midnight hour when the whole world sleeps, India will rise to freedom. At the stroke of the midnight hour when the whole world sleeps, India will rise to freedom and independence. So that has been a historic statement by Jawaharlal Nehru. And naturally, midnight, the idea of midnight, independence getting in the dead of the night. Well, there are many, many stories surrounding the, India's achievement of independence. But then Rushdie tries to suggest that there may be 1001 children born at that moment, 1947. And Salim's narrative is a joyous discovery of the midnight children through his Salim Sahib at All India Radio. His own miraculous telepathic gift, which provided communication for all the children. If there is a third principle, its name is childhood, but it dies rather, it is mother. That is an extremely sensitive point. The death of childhood. Salim is one of those 1001 gifted, talented, potential Indian children, no doubt. But Salim is also concerned about the fact that his childhood was murdered, like the childhood of many other children who were born at the same moment, at the same point of time in August 1947. Page 15, first paragraph. Rushdie himself talks about the origin, the inception of this book. He began with one child. These then became two as he thought of swapping them. So the child gets swapped. We shall know that Salim exactly doesn't belong to the present parents. He was swapped for Siba, who comes as an emerges as an antagonist at the end of the novel, we shall see. And Rani says, I did a mathematical calculation about the birthplace of India with calculators and worked out that in fact 1001 children is accurate. It's kind of fun. It takes a lot of liberty, it takes a lot of fun on the readers, for the readers, with the characters. And naturally, it becomes a baffling kind of novel, a baffling kind of narrative. In writing a novel about the Indian subcontinent, Rushdie, in one sense, belongs to the novelists who came before him, like Raja Rao, R.K. Narayan, or Mulkaj Anand and Anita Desai, and many others. Then there is some reference to Mulk Raj Anand, Raja Rao's Kanthapura, and R.K. Narayan's Malgudi and all that, which you know, we need not repeat. Then Booker Award. Booker Award and Booker of Booker Award. Two awards it backed, which is a rare achievement on the part of a writer, Commonwealth writer, a writer from India with Indian origin, or a Commonwealth writer. No Commonwealth writer has ever won these two awards, Booker Award and Booker of Bookers. Rushdie's exuberant humor, brilliant wit, imaginative boldness, Play 16, 1.6, critical reception. Very important. For your introduction, you can build up your introduction with information from this particular section. Wit, imaginative boldness, enormous talent, prodigious powers of storytelling. He's dead to Gabriel Garcia Marquez, Gunter Grass and Lawrence Stern. Gunter Grass from Germany, famous for Tin Drum. Again, a mind-blowing novel. And Lawrence Stern, Tristram Shandy, 18th century, who is supposed to be the first owes the debt asked Gabriel Garcia Marquez, Lawrence Stern, and Milan Kundera, the Czechoslovakian writer. And Midnight Children was greeted in all quarters. Anita Desai, whom you have already done, herself said, page 16, 1.6, critical reception, second paragraph. You can underline. Anita Desai says, describe his novel as being of major interest to Indian readers, and went on to characterize it as a great tour de force, a dazzling exhibition of the gifts of a new writer with both innocence and control, and see a stylistic brilliance. It's about the readers. An uninitiated reader totally baffled by the book. Heavy experimentations, absolutely daring experimentation of the media, tradition of writing, tradition of fairy tales, fantasies, bizarre, mimicry, a hybrid, a peculiar hybrid of a novel, which became a trendsetter for years to come. Then there is information on how Salman Rushdie's Midnight Children led to a lot of novels by Indian and English novelists. Then the younger family, Shashi Tharoor, the great Indian novel, and some of his contemporaries, powerful novels, but they are supposed to be under the shadow of this great, this absolutely daring experiment by Salman Rushdie. Okay. Midnight Children was awarded the prestigious Booker Prize. Its critical steps more for Rushdie's appointment over Grimes. For Grimes, he was disappointed, but it was compensated by Booker. Arun Mukherjee, Professor Arun Mukherjee, a critic. Look at page 17, third paragraph. Mukherjee critiques the novel from a feminist perspective. Feminism also an important critical theory which you should be abreast of, and argues that Rushdie's attitudes are distinctly patriarchal. Patriarchy. What is patriarchy? The male-dominated society, a society dominated by the males, where females are absolutely relegated to the background, exploited, tortured. So, say that. How Western readers classify the magic realist narrative that combine realism and fiction. Magic realism and fiction, both are combined in this novel, and an experiment conducted, etc. So the total number of essays written on midnight children is mind-boggling. So many critics, even so many books have been written on midnight children, critical works, critical books. They reflect a great variety of perspective and interpretation, suggesting thereby that midnight children is that kind of work which can only offer different meanings to different people all the time. Such is its universality or multivalence. I talked about multivalence of Shakespeare, multivalence of the great poets, multivalence of the great dramatists and novelists. So that has something to do with Rushdie's magnum opus, Midnight Children 2. Then de-doxified English, how English is being doxified. Page 20, very clearly written. The beginnings, R.K. Narayan, Rajarao, Bhattacharya, and G.V. Desani. Diction, dialogue, syntax, the post-1930s novelists, and the connection between the language, they were using, and the cultural baggage that went to teach. Every language carries its baggage. But an Indian writer is writing, he carries cultural baggage in India. There is doubt about it. How does the writer face it? How does the writer get the it? The problems about which these writers have been very vocal in the introduction to Kanthapura, or and in his autobiography, or Mulk Raj Anand in Untouchable itself, in the introduction, they have talked about this, how to get over this cultural baggage. You can never get over. Then how to through an alien language, the native's experience in the alien's language. That was the problem with Mulk Raj Anand, Raja Rao, Bhavani Bhattacharya, R.K. Narayan, even Anita Desai. But they did it marvelously well, we have already seen. So there is a lot of discussion on these predecessors of astrology. Rushdie on English and Englishes, page 24. You know, one kind of English, Englishes. Rushdie spoke of the English used by the British as the English written with a capital E. Page 25, last but one paragraph. And of the different Englishes as being written with small letter E. These Englishes were remakings of English inherited in the former colonial countries and societies by writers who aimed to use them for the purpose of writing about their own people and struggles in the aftermath of colonization. So the development of Englishes in the countries, the erstwhile colonies, Australia, New Zealand, Canada, India. So he is concerned about these Englishes. And the writer gets a freedom. The writer in India has his own freedom to use English, to bend the English language to his advantage, thereby creating a new English, a new kind of English. And that is what precisely happens in this novel, okay, Midnight Children. So Rushdie creates a kind of English which is hybridized. For example, he uses English, Hindi plus English, English. English as a pan-Indian language and not as a regional language. So naturally the focus is on Hinglish in place of any one regional language. Hinglish, page 25, second, third paragraph. Hinglish is a mixture of Hindi, the national language, and English. So Hinglish is an artificially created language. You'll be surprised to discover there are several sequences where English is used by Rushdie deliberately to poke fun, to expose. He uses the narrative as a multi-edged weapon. Okay? So, he uses the hybrid pan-Indian English to communicate the worldview and the emotion of his characters. Page 25, last but one paragraph. For example, there is a beautiful example. This kind of English was not attempted by Narayan or Rao or Anand. Okay. This kind of hybridization was never attempted by earlier writers. Rushdie does it deliberately. Rushdie does it deliberately because he has an ulterior motive, a hidden agenda. And what is that we shall be discovering as we, in course of time, go through the novel. It is very effective because it is easily recognizable as the speaking voice of the common man or women in India. Common man, that is another point. The common man comes to the center. Common man, the minor characters take the center stage in the personages of common man in this novel. That's a different story which you shall be focusing on at the end. But then, right now, in the novels of Narayan, Rao, and Anand, you always had to consciously suspend your belief that the Togawala or the sweeper were speaking in English. they were speaking in English. You have to suspend the your suspension of dis your suspension of disbelief, as you so as they say. You have to suspend your disbelief in order to understand, appreciate a particular piece of writing. There's a very traditional theory, let us say, a presupposition. But Rushdie in this novel does something absolutely fantastic. Look at the example. See, Padma attempts to cajole me from my desk. Salim is talking about Padma, his beloved, his fiancée, then his wife. Eat na, food is spoiling. Look at wrong English. Eat na, food is spoiled. I revenge some hands on paper. Padma snorts. Rish smacks across forehead. Okay, star. Cares to pic. Wrong English deliberately introduced to suggest that here is Padma, who is illiterate, as opposed to Salim, who claims himself to be highly literate, an extraordinarily gifted young man who has fallen in love with her, and Padma is being extra careful about Salim. But look at the language. Food is getting spoiled. Food is spoiling. Look at wrong English. Okay. Very interesting example. There are so many sequences. Okay. So hybridized English forms a very important aspect of this novel. As used by Rushdie, and as claimed by Rushdie himself and some of his followers, particularly critics, it is suggested that English is a decolonized form of English. Rushdie wanted to give a new shape, a new direction to English language by decolonizing it and making experiments. English becomes a development upon English. English becomes a decolonized form of English. Okay? It's an important point which you should remember. Then English is dedoxified. What is doxa? Look at page 28, third paragraph. Rula Barthes, post-structuralism. Structuralism, post-structuralism, post-colonialism, these are all post-modern theories. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, if you can hear me, please go through that book or another book by Pramod Nayar, Contemporary Critical and Cultural Theory. That's also a very good book. But I would request you to go through Reader's Guide to Contemporary Critical Theory and collect some points on these isms, postmodernism, postcolonialism, feminism, okay, reader response theory, etc. Because they will supplement your understanding of these absolutely mystifying developments in the history of fiction, particularly Indian English fiction, as conducted by the gentleman Salman Rushdie. Rula Barthes defined post-structuralism thought. He was instrumental in challenging all such natural constructions and exposing the political inventions of the powerful who were interested in keeping these ideological beliefs alive. Then there will be very important French writers who would be talking about power and the powerless. So Rula Barthes would be suggesting that the vested interests, the powerful people have the vested interests who always want to remain in power. Okay. they are always interested in keeping their ideology and beliefs alive. Rula Barthes described these as the doxa, or public opinion, or voice of the chair, and questioned if in truth they were natural or they were man-made. So doxa, from doxa you have dedoxified, dedoxification. Dedoxification means writing a given socio-economic, socio-cultural script in reverse. Page 28, last but one paragraph. Last but second paragraph. What a postmodern war do would be to represent the low caste as militant rather than the low caste people, when outcasts, socially marginalized people, they become militant. In a postmodern novel, Anand would have written the scene twice. Once as he has scripted it in the novel, and then again with the reverse script, wherein he would have shown Bakha, the hero of Untouchable, as returning the caste Hindu slap with a powerful blow that would have made the caste Hindu tremble in fear or run for his life. That would have happened, but that did not happen, because Bakha was aware of his own class. Whereas in a postmodern situation, things would have been different. That is what is suggested. So this would mean rewriting a given socio-cultural script in reverse order. Such rewritten reverse scripts create new realities that are as equally valid as the existing ones in which the superior group is privileged. So an entire range of ideologies can be challenged along these lines. For example, one may challenge the superiority of the man over woman, sanity over madness, white over black. So now, when the writer rewrites or re-scripts, when a writer rewrites or re-scripts given in the same language in a way, which is called dedoxification. But you have to have this, ladies and gentlemen, to go through
सर चिन्मय सर, तो अकेला था वो भी चला गया। अच्छा वो आ गए सर तो, लेकिन एक ही है। ठीक है, ये क्लास कर लीजिए, आगे से देखेंगे सर, आगे से शायद करने का जरूरत नहीं होगा। और सफिशियंट नंबर ऑफ स्टूडेंट नहीं आएंगे तो फिर क्लास करके फायदा क्या है। हाँ बस ये क्लास कंटिन्यू कर लीजिए, आगे देखेंगे। और स्टूडेंट आ गए सर, गीतांजलि यस आ गई। एक मिनट सर, एक मिनट। अच्छा हाँ सर, क्या बोल रहा।
There are several examples of Rushdie's use of English, hybridized English, hybridized. Hello, are you able to hear me? Hello?
Yes, sir.
So, page 29-30, there are several instances, very, very interesting sequences of the novel quoted. Look at page 29, 2.8, Rushdie's use of English in descriptive times, in descriptive scenes. I quote, round and round and round. Look at, put together, round and round and round. Finally, to please her, I stammered, okay, I think, I am, let me. And instantly, I was on my own. She had given a farewell soap. I heard her shouting, the brake, use the goddamn brake, yaar, dummy. But my hands could not move. I had gone rigid as a plank, and there I look out in front of me with the blue two-wheeler of Sony Ibrahim. Collision, course, out of the way, yeah, crazy. Look at the language. What is he up to? So the letters convey Salim's inner dialogue, the capital letters. Salim's inner dialogue, as he is trying to view a situation critically, where one of his adversaries, rivals, has appeared. So this use of language is present in many passages of the book. Similar is the arrival of spring in Kashmir. The novel settles between Bombay and to Kashmir, from Kashmir to Bombay, and again from Bombay to Karachi. Description of spring. The world was new again. After a winter's gestation in its excel of ice, the valley had baked its way out into the open, moist and yellow. The metaphor used is that of a newborn chick emerging out of its excel, bringing with itself a sense of something new, young, fresh, and just born. So many examples are there. You can pick up for yourself. Then you come to the themes in the next year. This is where readers falter, critics get confused, scholars debate, and there have been raging controversies. What kind of theme? How many themes have been fused together? And in trying to fuse together so many themes, रश्दी हैज एंडेड अप मिस्टिफाइंग द रीडर्स. हिस्ट्री एंड द इंडिविजुअल सलीम सिन्हा. द स्टोरी इज द स्टोरी ऑफ सलीम सिन्हा द प्रोटागोनिस्ट who is supposed to be a bastard. Salim Sena is a bastard whose story the author takes us pain to narrate in several sequences. We shall be knowing a lot about him a little later. But for the moment, Rushdie establishes a strong connection between the history of India and the life of Salim. Salim, the protagonist, the teller of the tale, teller of the story of midnight children, shares his history with India, with the history of India. Right from the moment of his birth, Salim is described as being mysteriously handcuffed to history. My destiny is indissolubly chained to those of my country. For the next 3 decades, there was no escape. His confession, look at, within quote, page 33, 3.2, History and the Individual, last but one paragraph. Thus, Rushdie sets the scene for us to believe a strange tale, if true, that Salim Sinai had been born in Bombay on 15th August 1947 at the stroke of the midnight hour, becomes the first child born in independent India, and that history is the history of free India. He is the first child. I think there are several times, 1001 children were born. But Salim, the credit goes to Salim because he is the first child born at the stroke of the midnight hour, and therefore he is the first child of independent India. And his story is the history of India. His story is the history of India. This is a very important point. A very important point in the novel, which you must not lose sight of. How he grows in importance. How he is made to grow in importance in the novel. Now he takes liberty. How he goes on turning things upside down. Absolutely mind-blowing details of Salim's adventures, misadventures, anger, protest, and all that. So history and independence are important sequence in this book. In the history of India, General Dyer, General Ward, to this absolutely sensitive moment in the intelligent and clever manner. Very cleverly, very imaginatively, to this unfortunate moment in the history of pre and post independence India. From 1947, 32 years of history, which this novel covers, till the declaration of emergency by Indira Gandhi in 1975. How? Hello? Hello? Are you able to hear me? It's a history of 32 years, which Rushdie covers in this novel. Hello? Any problem? Are you able to hear me? Are you hear me, please? Hello? Is there a communication gap?
Yes, sir.
You are able to hear me? Okay. There is some problem with light here. Try to manage, try to adjust. Okay. So pre-independence and post-independent India, historical developments, how Rasdi has been reacting to these developments. The history in Midnight Children is as much fiction as any other. So there is nothing called history. On history, on reality, there are many more things in the subsequent chapter we'll see. But Rasdi is outright rejecting the history of India as made up. And what does he say? History which is usually linear and chronological, his mission is clear, and he obviously shows the desire to his material that the reader will be forced to accept in non-objective nature. Second paragraph, page 35. The narrator is designing his stories as per his whim, as per the guy of his nation. Central rule is that the smaller the text, such as wrong date of important event, including Gandhi's assassination, indicates that Salim is capable of consciously distorting facts. This is important. I told you when Rasdi was caught in the wrong foot by the kids in an interview, he heaped all the blames on his narrator, who he called an unreliable narrator. That is exactly the same thing. Distorting, he distorts facts. If the date of the assassination of Gandhi has been long recorded by him, okay? But another important point. Rasdi is not happy, has never been happy with the idea that people have accepted, people have viewed Midnight Children as a book of history than as a fiction. No, my intention was to write a fiction, and I have written a fiction. I am sorry that many of my readers have viewed it as history. No, I am not history, I am a novelist. I use historical materials, all right, but I don't claim to have a definitive history of India. I don't claim to have a definitive history of India. This is subject to moments of interest, moments of wonder, and series of us. That becomes the protagonist. A protagonist giving wrong information, a protagonist giving a wrong interpretation, this is a part of the narrative strategy. What kind of given to his whims and caprices, who is in taking the reader high, and Salim takes the reader for a ride on many occasions. Yes. Very, very important sequence. Thematic developments. In politics, Tanda by 1975 declares Indira Gandhi in power. And the emergency lasting from 1975 to 1977, almost a year. Why did she do that? Does the justify that Indira Gandhi wanted to save herself from going to prison? And that's the great emergency declaration of emergency is felt a gravest threat to Indian democracy since independence, especially because of the arsenal that Mrs. Gandhi had given to the nation for its imposition. The emergency was necessary to save the country from external threat. The job of a minister before declaration of emergency is to brief the president. When she went to the president, she said she had persuaded the president of India that it was necessary to save the country from external threat while there was none. No external threat. 1975. Things were going fine, absolutely. No threat, either from China or from any other country. She convinced easily the president that India was under external threat, and so even at the time. And 25, some of you may remember writers, activists, social activists, the rights suspended. You say things, the claim that you are justifying, you will be arrested and locked in jail. That is what precisely happened. Thousands and thousands of people were locked in jail. Freedom of speech was absolutely taken away. That is the dark hour in the history of the democracy. As he has indicated the theme of this novel. Okay. And thousands of people, young men, Punjab, Delhi, through his character to the character of Salim. Rushdie is trying to represent not a nation full of hope, but a nation whose voice has been muzzled and which is in a hopeless state because of the historical political events. So you feel like asking, what is Rushdie really doing to history in creating a character like Salim? We talk of history, historical material, incorporating history, writing historical fiction. How does Rushdie view history? That's a very, very important point to look at. Has any other Indian English writer before Rushdie used history as a theme? Well, there have been many writers. You talk of Raja. Use of historical material in creative writing dates back to the time of Epics. In this sense, we have Raja Rao, Khushwant Singh, Chaman Nahal, Manohar Malgaonkar, and many others. Rushdie, by contrast, is trying to suggest that history is a lie. History is a falsification of facts. So history is a big lie. History is made up. Reality is made up. These are the two very important points which you have to bear in mind. Then there is some reference to Raja Rao's Kanthapura. Then there is reference to Franz Fanon. Post-colonialism, I was talking about Franz Fanon, the Richard of the art, where he registered very, very important issues on the Samuel issues. Richard of the art, Franz Fanon, the leading post-colonialism, he first came to Edward Said. Four important names in postcolonial list. The first place, the writers in the former colonies.
मंडे कंटिन्यू कर आज बोले आप नेटवर्क प्रॉब्लम अच्छी तो मंडे आम कंटिन्यू कर मंडे अच्छे ट्यूजडे अच्छे जो दिन अच्छे एक्स्ट्रा टाइम ना आप देदेव नेक्स्ट क्लास के गोटे मिनट सब देखे हाँ मंडे दु तारीख मंडे हाँ सर एक तारीख सर एक तारीख एक तारीख मंडे एक तारीख अच्छे हाँ सर ना बारंबार कटिले आपको भी कंटिन्यूटी रही भी कंटिन्यूटी रही ना आप लॉगिन करेंगे कौन हाँ सर ना देखते जो ये कटिगला पे कहीदे हाँ आसीगले आप आसीगले ठीक अच्छे ओके सर
Achievement of a very high order is not easy because it is obvious that he is writing the novel where the life of the individual unity of the name, not as a fictional gimmick but as an attempt to create an emotional spot in the reader about the most sad and disturbing event in the history of free India. That sad and disturbing incident is emergency. Okay. Interestingly, Rushdie's Midnight Children triggered off a new mode of fiction writing among Indian English novelists. I have already referred to that. So Rushdie is the first Indian novelist, page 37, last but one paragraph, who consciously uses history in fiction to show its subjective, untruthful nature and its easy manipulation by modern-day governments. History can be manipulated. And history can be written as per their directive. We shall come to that a little later again when we cover Indira Gandhi appearing in the image of Goddess Kali or Durga, trying to reshape, rewrite the history of India. Anyway, untruthful nature and its nature. Yes, he describes historical events through the emotions of his characters. To reveal the trivial role played by the individual in countering powerful modern-day governments, it does it in a mock heroic, absurd way. So, mock heroic manner, the manner of mock heroic mode of presentation. You know, mock heroic, 18th century British literature, mock epic, mock heroic. They're not really heroic. It is mock heroic. They will ape heroism. Ape heroism, and they are not really heroes. So deliberately, he chooses this mock heroic mode to satirize, to expose, to puncture self-created history of the contemporary times by these so-called political leaders. Then colonialism and new colonialism, India. In the absence of colonizers have left us, the Britishers have gone away. India remains a colony nevertheless. Whose colony? The colony of the ruling class, the colony of the men in power, the colony of a particular family, Gandhi family. Scathing criticism, uncompromising, relentless, scathing attack and exposure of Gandhi family Nehru Gandhi family. Okay, so that is how Rushdie in Kantapura, sorry, Rushdie in Midnight Children does what Rao attempted to do earlier in Kantapura. There is a chapter titled Methold. Methold is a very important character on whose name there is a title. Chapter 7. Methold is represented in pristine beauty and populated by the therefore called police. How the British has changed the geography of India. This man almost eliminated them from the scene. That is what is the idea. 38 is a caricature, a symbol of evil and moral degeneration rather than a fully fleshed out character. This method, the man who claims that he was the officer who successfully realized a vision of a British Bombay when in 1668. The East India Company did get its hands on the island. And the worst of all, so that is a folk. Is the character of the city in the middle. Page 38, a longer paragraph in the middle, talking of chapter 7. This gentleman, William Methold, is William Methold, plays a crucial role in the narrative. When Rushdie is trying to clock back, he's overtaken by regret, nostalgia, profound sorrow at the thought of how these fishermen of Bombay were eliminated virtually by the British folk, the agents of East India Company, especially this officer, Methold, William Methold. And that is because of the overriding notion which Britishers projected on their behalf. What is that? They have come to India to civilize India. They have come to India to civilize its people. India is uncivilized. We have come here to civilize. That is what you come to know whenever you see a film of the pre-partition days. Even the film on Subhas Bose does talk of that, the forgotten hero. Okay. So Rushdie's method is a caricature, a symbol of evil and moral degeneration. Rushdie uses method to convey his views about colonialism. Methold is a descendant of the Methold who was the first officer of the East India Company, and he is the last European to rule India before India got its freedom. The last officer of the East India Company before India has its freedom. The first and last Englishman thus becomes the direct object of Rushdie's anger, as he symbolizes for him the entire colonial adventure of exploitation, degeneration and demoralization. There is reference to Franz Fanon once again. The third phase of writing, according to Franz Fanon, when the writers criticize and expose their own people, their own politicians, their own policy makers, that is what Rushdie precisely does here, and belongs to the third phase of writing, as visualized by Franz Fanon in The Wretched of the Earth. So the myth of the Britain's civilizational mission is exposed. That the Britishers were hypocrites, that the Britishers were essentially cheats, exploiters, has been systematically exposed by Rushdie through various sequences of the narrative. even the gentleman Mithold believes that India should remain within the framework as visualized by the British people, by the British government. India should retain the economic, political framework of the British, etc. He had no business. You are leaving India, leave it. Who are you to advise us? Anyway, but they do it. They did it. And that is what also was the in Mindai's children. The hypocrisy and double standard. Hypocrisy and double standard of the Britishers, represented by their agent William Methold, has been beautifully dramatized to various sequences. Page 40, in the middle, long paragraph. That is where you get a lot of, when you're talking about Ahmad Sinai, his friends, the departing British had troop plan, psychological conditioning ensured the conditioning, continued slavery of the Indian. The psychological conditioning. They're trying to condition the Indians, particularly those people around administration. Psychological conditioning to accept the British, to accept all that is British, or that was done by the British. So that is what Rushdie is trying to expose with terrible anger, and hatred. And that is the making of a writer. A writer who deflates the pattern of history visualized by the so-called men in power and suggesting that history is all hoax, history is a lie. History has no real basis. It is made up. The stance taken by Rushdie in this novel is a stance taken by Jacques Derrida, the father of deconstruction. Jacques Derrida's agenda was to turn upside down the myths surrounding European intellectual history. Something like that is being done by these gentlemen here. That is my opinion. Don't quote me. What Jacques Derrida did in the history of literary criticism, literary theory, was to expose the limitations of European theories, the European aesthetics. Something like that is being done, attempted here by Rushdie, who turned upside down the tradition of fiction writing, who even questions the Western methodology of fiction writing, the Western concept of mimetic realism. All things are there, all these things are there. So for the moment, we must believe that the hypocrisy and double standard of the British as represented by William Methold is being thoroughly exposed. And thus this uncompromising tone is evident everywhere. Rushdie Salim notes in his narrative how Ahmad Sinai begins to grow fairer in complex and day by day. Page 40, last but one paragraph. Growing fairer day by day. There is a little funny scene, can you recall it? There is a scene where a large number of Indian businessmen, including Ahmad, get up on morning and find that they have turned white. Obviously, killing British, pro-British folk. And then they discover in the morning that they have turned white. Rai has said in his interview that this is an imagery he had used to show that they were dreams, etc. This is fantasy. Exposure of British colonialism through the use of fantasy. Fantasy is a narrative mode like magic realism. Okay, it's a branch, you will say it's a branch of magic realism. So he fantasizes, and through fantasy he exposes this pro-British Indian people, the hypocrites. Okay, who were trying to tow the British line, towing the British line. Okay. Then British colonialism, long-lasting effects in neo-colonialism, etc., etc. Then comes a very, very important moment: fragmentation, migrancy, and memory. The novel is a product of this. This novel is an offshoot of a series of developments such as fragmentation, migrancy, and memory. The developments in the third world, in the pre and post independence of India, the feeling of the writers, the expatriate writers living abroad, trying to come back to mother country but not able to come back, but nursing the feelings of deterritorialization. Deterritorialization. They have been deterritorialized, far away from India, always pining to come to India, not able to come to India. Why? India will not be the right place for them because of their status. Their status has changed, remaining in London, in America, in New York, Washington, California, Germany, Stuttgart. Their status is different. They are conscious of their Indian origin. They have the pangs for coming back to India, but they are not good. They are not prepared to come back. Territorialization and re-territorialization. Look at their intention. This expatriate writer, there are so many, including Salman Rushdie. They are trying to re-territorialize themselves, but not able to do that. But they are anchoring the feeling that they are deterritorialized because they are far away from their motherland. So that creates a tension, a dichotomy in expatriate writing. And we have such writings immensely available in the third world countries, in Africa, in America, and in the developed countries like America and Great Britain and Germany. We have enough of such writing. There is a reference to George Lamming in The Castle of My Skin. In his non-fictional work, The Pleasures of Exile, George Lamming highlights, he's from West Indies, Barbadian writer, George Lamming, famous for his book, In the Castle of My Skin, has written a non-fictional work titled The Pleasures of Exile, 1960, page 42, second paragraph, very important information, okay? What does he say? It highlights sensitively the terrible dilemma and the divided feelings that a migrant writer from the third world experiences in the West. When you are in the West, you are from the third world. But you are in the West, what kind of experiences you have? The terrible dilemma, the sensitivity, as I was telling you. The dilemma is, it is painful to stay, but it is difficult to return. It is painful to stay with the memory of the motherland, but it is difficult to return to my motherland. That is the dilemma. That is the dichotomy which has been celebrated by all these expatriate writers, okay? Including Rushdie. There are some other moments, page 42. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 paragraph. Fragmentation, migrancy, and memory. This third theme can perhaps be called the central theme of not just Midnight Children, but all the novels. Rushdie, who is aware of its centrality in his life, has written extensively on this subject. In many of his novels, not merely in Midnight Children, in almost all his mature novels, he has talked about migrancy, about fragmentation, not society, you can't hear society. Merely plays a pivotal role. Protagonist of this novel. Okay, that is a central theme. And the final deduction is the migrant writers can only create fiction. Invisible cities, imaginary homeland. Because of this tension, this dichotomy, because of this contradiction, the migrant writers finally create what? Imaginary homelands, invisible cities, and absolute fiction. That is the ultimate realization of the critics and scholars about the centrality or the central focus of these expatriate writers. Okay. Page 43, very, very important piece of information. Please go through. Have patience. The images of fragmentation. Page 43, long paragraph. Adam Aziz, Salim refers to his fragmented being. Look at, very, very important. Salim refers to his fragmented being, number one. Number two, Adam Aziz, his grandfather, confesses to having a permanent hole the size of a melon inside me. Look at self, I mean, he's satirizing his own self. A hole of the size of a melon, because he can never completely rid himself of his alienness. That was the experience of Adam Aziz. Adam Aziz, the grandfather of Salim. Number three, he describes himself as a half and halfer. Half and halfer, incomplete life, half-lived life, okay? The images of fragmentation, the whole and half, there's a hole of the size of a melon in me, and I've been a half and a halfer. Very painful images, very, very painful, very images of a, I mean, recorded by a sensitive soul. Highlight the predicament as a person who has fallen between two stools, having been exposed to two very different cultures, the Indian and the Western. Okay, so he also represents the expatriate. He also partakes of the expatriate writer's feelings and emotions. Okay, that is very intelligently dramatized by Rushdie. The images of fragmentation highlights the predicament. Yes. Then you have, it is the cause letter of his estrangement from his wife. In deference to his past, his mother, the Thai boatman, he tries to be a good Muslim, but he only hurts himself and the hole persists. He wants to become a good Muslim, but that hole persists in his being. It is not on his body, but in his being, in his soul. He feels oppressed by narrow thinking and religious bigotry, which rule India even today. It is the cause later of his estrangement from his wife, Naseem, also called Reverend Mother in the novel. Point number four, India is partitioned into Pakistan. Pakistan is further partitioned into Bangladesh and Pakistan. Six, Salim has several parts of his body lopped off from a finger to his sexual organs. Seven, families fragment. Eight, marriages break up. Nine, fragmented parentage makes it possible for Salim to claim child of an unknown union. Salim is a bastard. That realization. child of an unknown union. I have had more mothers than most mothers have children. I have made most mothers. So many women have been my mothers. I don't know actually. Look at. Strange, very, very strange, mystifying. Giving birth to parents. As one of my stronger talents. I have been giving birth to parents. I have been giving birth to parents. Look at, terrible, absolutely terrible. Satire at its nadir. Satire, self-satire at its nadir in the hands of Salman Rushdie, okay? So, child of an unknown union. So emotionally insecure, Salim labors under the fear of losing his parents' love, except under certain conditions of accessible behavior. Why is he afraid of losing parents' love? He has always anchored that apprehension that I may be losing the love of my parents. Why? Salim's obsession with the tracing of an ancestry is attempt to come to terms with the problems of a divided identity. Intellectually, he is drawn to the West, while his emotional being looks for the moorings in the mother country. West, East-West encounter, longing for the mother country, and at the same time, the push and the pull from the West. Look at page 43, one paragraph, very important. Salim is apparently descended from the ancestral line of Ramaji himself, alienated half and half on Kashmir. He's being the child of William Methold. Look at discovery, the reader. He's being the child of William Methold, the last Britisher in India, and Vanita. He's the son of Methold and Vanita, not known to the readers. Look at. Salim himself is exposing. Compounds the Kashmiri alienation with the colonials. Being a bastard is Salim's literal situation. Being a bastard is Salim's literal situation. Okay? Metaphorically, it equals the typical migrant. A typical migrant condition of a lack of belonging. A migrant writer, a migrant citizen, I mean human being, a migrant intellectual. What does he suffer from? That's lack of sense of belonging, the lack of belonging. Okay. So exile undoubtedly shapes and colors Salim's perspective on life. He's a perpetual permanent exile, a perpetually suffering the pangs of exile because of this prehistory of his birth. Because of this history of his birth and prehistory of his birth, he has been anchoring that sense of that lack of sense of belonging. Exile shapes and colors Salim's perspective on life. Exile undoubtedly shapes and colors Salim's perspective on life. That I am an exile. Permanently exiled. Where? Even he doesn't know. Look at it. Repeatedly confronted with the condition of exile, Salim begins to ponder its shocks and dents upon his personality. The shocking, it is absolutely shocking for him. He can't compromise, but he has to accept. It is a shocking experience for the protagonist. And Salim becomes a homeless wanderer. His sadness and gloom echo the expatriates. He represents essentially an expatriate writer full of sadness and gloom. His first exile is in losing the home of Vanita and wee, willy, winky from his very birth. This wee, willy, winky is a street accordionist. His father. But he's not.